Compared to the reporting from Egypt or the continuing coverage of the battle for Libya, we've heard very little about what's happening in the Gulf state of Bahrain. But it hasn't been spared the turmoil that has beset the region in recent months. Anti-government activists there have been brutally attacked by government security forces, and the crackdown continues. Dateline's Yara Boumalam first tried to enter Bahrain 2 weeks ago. She was turned back at the airport just as demonstrators were being gassed and fired upon. But Yara persisted and has managed to enter the country on her second attempt. Here's her investigation.
On the edge of the capital, Manama, thousands gather for the funeral of a young man. Hani Juma was 32 years old and the father of two children. It's a scene repeated over and over in Bahrain, where there are more and more killings, more and more funerals, as the nation is torn by protests and a brutal government crackdown. I wanted to find out just what happened to the man whose death has brought so many onto the streets. But it's difficult moving freely here.
We're approaching another checkpoint now.
I find my way to this empty building on the outskirts of the city.
So this is the building that Hani Jumar's body was found in. He was pursued by riot police as they were conducting a sweep through the neighbourhood.
Tirana Hassan, an Australian, is from Human Rights Watch's Emergency Response Unit.
Essentially, they found him lying unconscious where he had been bleeding out for about 2 hours.
It wasn't easy to capture these images. Even though I have permission to work as a journalist here, it's clear that there are some stories Bahrain doesn't want the world to see.
You can see from the nature of the blood here that there was an enormous amount of blood loss. And when we came, we found fragments of his kneecap. We also found one of his teeth.
Tirana Hassan says that Juma wasn't even taking part in the anti-government protests when he was attacked. He was simply caught up in a police sweep when he went outside his home after hearing calls for help.
What we found here is different to a number of the other investigations we've done. This was the scene of something calculated and cruel and carried out by riot police.
Hani Juma was then taken to Bahrain's central hospital and stabilised. But doctors told Human Rights Watch that security officials came looking for him. They found him in a hospital bed and took him away.
His body turned up approximately 4 days later. And the family was just told to come and collect the body.
The mourners at Hani Jamar's funeral believe that what happened to him could happen to any of them. And funerals like this can quickly turn into anti-government protests, as this one has, with demonstrations now officially banned in the city centre. The uprising in Bahrain began in mid-February. Pearl Square in the city centre became like Cairo's Tahrir Square, the focal point of demonstrations. the government called for backup from Saudi Arabia and the United Arab Emirates. Then Bahraini police turned their guns on the protesters. Many civilians were killed. At the height of the violence, when medical help was critical, even hospitals came under attack by the military. This secretly filmed footage appears to show a male nurse being dragged behind bushes and bashed outside Bahrain's central Salmaniyah hospital. Even doctors were targeted, like this woman, who wanted to speak to me but was too afraid to show her face on camera.
Every doctor that speaks out in the media is being arrested.
She was waiting for an influx of seriously injured protesters when the riot police came to visit.
We looked through our windows and we saw vehicles, police, riot police vehicles, and riot police just walking around the gates and around the entrances of Salmaniyah Hospital. And then they occupied all the entrances and exits of Salmaniyah, not allowing anybody, whether a doctor or a patient, to come in or go out. Male staff nurses, they were dragged to the backside parking, and they were beaten so hardly by the riot police till they were lying on the ground and they couldn't move. They were just lying on the ground.
What's the situation now for Salmaniyah Hospital?
It's like a prison now. It turned like a prison. Nobody can come in or out unless going through several checkpoints. The administration now is military.
I wanted to find out more about what happened there, and the doctor offered to take me to a man now in hiding.
So, just going to the house of someone who was a patient at Salmaniyah Hospital, and he's going to tell us what it was like to be there.
This man, who I'll call Ali, was also too afraid to be filmed. He had been injured by a shotgun blast while protesting at the Pearl Square roundabout and managed to get to the hospital. Ali told me that he and other patients had been forcibly removed from the hospital and were taken to a police station where the beatings continued.
The access to health services to the injured people is a guarantee, and people need to have the right to be able to access those. These are not quasi-detention centres where people can be held incommunicado. Health facilities need to be places which are protected and that medical professionals, including paramedics and ambulances, can operate freely.
As news of such atrocities leaked out, the government called a press conference, claiming security forces had actually liberated the hospital.
Blocking hospitals. Who blocked the hospitals? It's not the government or the army. The army opened the hospital of Salmaniyah because we have clear evidence and we have many cases to show, and they can be provided to you, how people were denied access to Salmaniyah Hospital and how Salmaniyah Hospital became a source of misinformation and also of, in many cases, violence against nurses, doctors and patients. So actually the hospital was open and liberated for all to use it.
And then they're shooting people killing people, beating people till death.
But this man believes none of what the government is saying.
I opened the door and they pushed me and they say, where is your bedroom? Where is your bedroom? And they were holding me from my shirt, pulling me from my shirt. And they went and pulling me inside, going up to my bedroom.
2 weeks ago, Nabil Rajab was visited by 25 masked men with guns. There were police, military and thugs, outraged over his work as a human rights activist.
I mean, while I was here in front of my children, they were insulting me, saying all the sectarian statement and speech and accusation, and telling me that you have to prepare yourself, we're going to rape you now.
Nabil was bashed and interrogated for 3 hours before being released. He says he considers himself lucky.
We have more than 100 people missing. We don't know if they're dead or alive. We have a lot of people got arrested, many political and human rights figures. Human rights defenders are in detention now.
Nabil questions what role the presence of a major U.S. naval base here has in the way the West has reacted to the violence.
It is sad to see that their interest and their relation with those repressive regime has more importance than the life and the human right of the people of this country.
All over town, I find stories of abuse and fear.
She's saying that she doesn't feel safe here to talk.
Democracy activist Zainab Al-Khawaji introduces me to her aunt Fatima, whose husband has now gone missing.
If you can try not to get like the plate numbers or the house so that they don't get in trouble. Okay.
Fatima tells me how her children had been forced to give up their father at gunpoint.
يا سيدة حطوا في راسهم المسدس قالوا لهم إذا ما تقولون وين الرجال اللي عندكم هني نطلق عليكم سيدة طفل يعني قال لي فوق بابا راحوا لي طبعا أخذوا
Fatima says she was then bashed and sexually assaulted.
طفى علي طبعا الضوء هي خمسة أنا واجس يعني كنت حاسة بالرعب الشديد كنت خايفة على يعني أكثر ما كنت يعني على هالضرب الضرب القاسي والمبرح ما كنت يعني خايفة على شيء غير إنه خايفة على شرفي وقولي كلمات كلش حقيرة وبديئة يعني حتى حركات ما أقدر أقولها شلون يسوي لي هو يعني نفسه هيك يسوي لي يجي لي في وجهي يسوي لي يعني يجي
One week on from the raid, and still, it's clearly left its mark. Fatima has still not heard from her husband, and she fears she may never see him again.
There needs to be an investigation into those that have been disappeared. Information needs to be made available on where people are and what charges, if any, they are being detained.
You said that you were hopeful that the society...
Bahrain's Minister for Foreign Affairs says investigations are already underway. But he's not referring to his security forces, only to activists who've been locked up.
I don't want to interfere with the course of justice. They will be tried before the courts, and we will see the evidence against them. Let's not affect the course of the justice now, and let's wait to see what the court says, please.
And he insists that protests here have nothing to do with anti-government sentiment, but are the result of tensions between the majority Shias and Sunnis.
They tried to push the situation to a sectarian way so that they present it as a Shia-Sunni dispute. It's not like a dispute. People want a legitimate right. Yes, the majority of people protesting, they are Shias because they're more marginalized. They are more discriminated against, but doesn't mean that the Sunnis are living in beautiful heaven.
The next day, security around town is as tight as ever.
Just put my camera down.
لا لا كلش بعرف اذا بك خلي كاميرا مني انا اقلب مني مو مشكلة. بس ما في الوقت. لا لا لا.
فيديو.
Many of the highways are empty, with people preferring to stay in the relative safety of their homes. I try to reconnect with Zainab as her aunt continues a search for her husband, but again, I'm blocked.
The military didn't let us through, and we tried to get Zainab through as well, and they kept asking questions about her ID, so we thought it would be safer for her to go.
Put down your camera.
We're approaching another checkpoint now.
That night, I hear that another protest has started up, and I set off in search of it. The streets appear to be deserted. Eventually, I find it. A candlelit vigil in the suburbs. They know how dangerous this is, that police could come here at any time. But the urge for reform pushes them on. They tell me they'll be back again tomorrow night, and the night after that, and the night after that too.
Yara Boumelam, filming and reporting there. And Human Rights Watch has now completed an update into the death of Hani Jumar. You can find their link on our website, plus there's an interactive guide to all of the unrest in the Middle East. And in a special behind-the-scenes report, Yara looks at the difficulties of working in different languages with the team that translates our stories here at SBS. That's at sbs.com.au/dateline. Up next, settle in for some back-breaking action as Bolivia's wrestling women take to the ring. They're the equal of any man, but the pay is poor and the risk is high.
Bien me lastimado en este viaje que hicimos. Y también aquí un poco de la clavícula, donde no está con morete, pero sí me duele. Y las partes de las costillas.
And a tiny island in the Indian Ocean, which, like Australia, is grappling with the issues of immigration detention centres.
It's a very big scandal what is happening here. In terms of human rights, it is, really.